Time Warner Audiobooks presents The Empire Strikes Back.
This is what I call cold. Luke Skywalker's voice broke the silence he had observed since leaving the newly established rebel base hours earlier. He was astride a tauntaun, the only other living being as far as the eye could see. He felt tired and alone, and the sound of his own voice startled him. Luke and his fellow members of the Rebel Alliance took turns exploring the white wastelands of Hoth, gathering information about their new home. Peering out at the icy wastes through his goggles, Luke pulled his fur-lined cap down more snugly about his head. A settler would have to be crazy to stake his claims on Hoth, he thought. This planet doesn't have a thing to offer anyone, except us. The Rebel Alliance had established an outpost on the ice world little more than a month before. There was nothing to contradict early findings that no intelligent life existed on this cold planet. Luke spurred his tauntaun. Come on, girl, he urged. The snow lizard's gray body was insulated from the cold by a covering of thick fur. The tauntaun's llama-like head thrust forward, and its serpentine tail coiled behind as the beast galloped up the ice slope on its muscular hind legs. The animal's horned head turned from side to side, buffeting the winds that assaulted its shaggy muzzle. At the top of an ice slope, Luke brought the animal to a halt. He pulled off his dark-lensed goggles and squinted just long enough for his eyes to adjust to the blinding glare of the snow. Suddenly, his attention was diverted by the appearance of an object streaking across the sky, leaving behind a lingering trail of smoke as it dipped toward the misty horizon. Luke flashed his gloved hand to his utility belt and clutched his pair of electro binoculars. Apprehensive, he felt a chill that competed with the coldness of the Hoth atmosphere. What he had seen could have been man-made, perhaps even something launched by the Empire. He followed its fiery course and watched as it crashed on the white ground and was consumed in its own explosive brilliance. At the sound of the explosion, the tauntaun shuddered. A fearful growl escaped its muzzle, and it began to claw nervously at the snow. Luke patted the animal's head. Easy, girl, he shouted over the blustering wind. It's just another meteorite. The animal calmed, and Luke brought the communicator to his mouth. Echo 3 to Echo 7. Han, old buddy, do you read me? Static crackled from the receiver. Then a familiar voice cut through the interference. Is that you, kid? What's up? I've finished my circle, and I haven't picked up any life readings, Luke spoke into his comlink. There isn't enough life on this ice cube to fill a space cruiser, Han Solo answered, fighting to make his voice heard above the whistling winds. My sentry markers are placed. I'm heading back to base. See you shortly, Luke replied. He still had his eye on the twisting column of dark smoke rising from a black spot in the distance. A meteorite just hit here, and I want to check it out. I won't be long. Clicking off his comlink, Luke turned his attention to his tauntaun. The reptilian creature was pacing and gave out a deep-throated roar that seemed to signal fear.
"Whoa, girl," he said, patting the tauntaun's head. "What's the matter? You smell something? Oh, there's nothing out there."
But Luke, too, was beginning to feel uneasy. He knew these snow lizards had keen senses. The animal was trying to tell Luke that something, some danger, was near. Luke removed a small object from his utility belt and adjusted its miniature controls. The sensitive device could zero in on even the most minute life readings by detecting body temperatures and internal life systems. But as Luke began to scan the readings, a shadow crossed over him, towering above by a good meter and a half. Luke spun around, and suddenly it seemed as if the terrain itself had come to life. A great white furred bulk, perfectly camouflaged against the sprawling mounds of snow, rushed savagely at him. Luke's hand blaster never cleared its holster. The huge claw of the Wampa ice creature struck him hard and flat against his face, knocking him off the tauntaun and into the freezing snow. He never heard the pitiful screams of the tauntaun, never felt his own ankle savagely gripped by his giant hairy attacker, or felt his body dragged like a lifeless doll across the snow-covered plain. Black smoke was still rising from the depression in the hillside where the airborne thing had fallen to form a smoldering crater, the dark fumes being dispersed by the icy Hoth winds. Within the crater, something stirred. First, there was only a sound, a droning mechanical sound, swelling in intensity. Then the thing moved. Something glinted in the bright afternoon light as it slowly began to rise. The object appeared to be some form of alien organic life, its head a multi-orbed, skull-like horror, its dark-lensed blister eyes training their cold gaze across the even colder reaches of wilderness. But as the thing rose higher from the crater, its form showed it clearly to be a machine of some sort, equipped with cameras, sensors, and metal appendages, some of which terminated in crab-like grasping pincers. The machine hovered over the smoking crater, and then a signal was set off within its internal mechanical systems, and the machine began to float across the icy plain. The dark probe droid soon vanished over the distant horizon. Another rider, bundled in winter clothing and mounted on a spotted gray tauntaun, raced across the slopes of Hoth toward the rebel base of operations. The man's eyes, like points of cold metal, glanced without interest at the domes of dull gray, the myriad gun turrets, and the colossal power generators that were the only indications of life on this world. Han Solo gradually slowed his snow lizard, guiding the reins so the creature trotted through the entrance of the enormous ice cave. The subterranean base was both a natural ice cave and a maze of angular tunnels blasted from a solid mountain of ice by rebel lasers. Han dismounted, then glanced around at the activity taking place inside the mammoth cave. Wherever he looked, he saw things being carried, assembled, or repaired. Rebels in gray uniforms rushed to unload supplies and adjust equipment. And there were robots, mostly R2 units and power droids, that seemed to be everywhere, rolling or walking through the ice corridors. Han wondered if he were mellowing with age. At first he had had no personal interest in or loyalty to this whole rebel affair. And then he had found himself rescuing a princess from the Empire's most feared battle station, the Death Star. The princess, Leia Organa. The more Solo thought about her, the more he realized how much trouble he had bought himself by accepting Ben Kenobi's money. All Han had wanted was to collect his fee for taking Kenobi, young Luke Skywalker, and two droids to the Alderaan system, and then rocket back to pay some bad debts that hung over his head. He had never intended to become a hero. And yet, something kept him around to join Luke and his crazy rebel friends as they launched the now legendary space attack on the Death Star. Han still couldn't decide just what that something was. Now, long after the Death Star's destruction, Han was still with the Rebel Alliance, lending his assistance to establish this base on Hoth, one of the most desolate hellholes in the galaxy. But all that was about to change, he told himself. As far as he was concerned, Han Solo and the Rebels were about to blast off on divergent courses. He walked rapidly through the underground hangar deck, where several Rebel fighter ships were docked and being serviced by men in gray, assisted by droids of various designs. Of greatest concern to Han was the saucer-shaped freighter ship resting on its newly installed landing pods. The Millennium Falcon, the largest ship in the hangar, had garnered a few new dents in its metal hull since Han first hooked up with Skywalker and Kenobi. But then, looks hadn't made her famous. It was speed. Chewbacca, Han's giant Wookiee co-pilot, was repairing the Millennium Falcon's central lifter when Solo approached. The 2-meter-tall mountain of brown hair stopped his work and raised his face shield, exposing his furry countenance. A growl that few non-Wookiees in the universe could translate roared from his toothy mouth.
Cold isn't the word for it, Chewie.
He noticed the smoky wisps rising from the newly welded section of metal.
How are you coming with those lifters?
Chewbacca replied with a typical Wookiee grumble.
All right, Han said. I'll go report, and I'll give you a hand. As soon as those lifters are fixed, we're out of here.
The Wookiee barked, a joyful chuckle, and returned to his work as Han continued through the artificial ice cavern. The command center was alive with electronic equipment and monitoring devices reaching toward the icy ceiling. The man Han Solo had come to see was busily engaged behind a great console, his attention riveted to a computer screen flashing brilliantly colored readouts. Reken, wearing the uniform of a rebel general, straightened to face Solo as he approached.
General, there isn't a hint of life in the area, Han reported. But all the perimeter markings are set, so you'll know if anyone comes calling.
As usual, General Reken did not smile at Solo's flippancy, but he admired the young man's taking a kind of unofficial membership in the rebellion.
Has Commander Skywalker reported in yet?
He asked.
He's checking out a meteorite that hit near him. He'll be in soon. General, I think it's time for me to move on.
Han's attention was drawn from the general to an approaching figure. Her walk was both graceful and determined. Her feminine features somehow incongruous with her white combat uniform.
You're good in a fight, the general was saying. I hate to lose you.
Thank you, General, but there's a price on my head. If I don't pay off Jabba the Hutt, I'm a walking dead man.
Before the general could respond, Han turned to the princess.
I guess this is it, Your Highness.
That's right, Leia replied coldly. Han shook his head. For a while, he had begun to believe that there was at least one female in all the cosmos he was beginning to understand. Well, he had been wrong before.
Don't go all mushy on me, princess. So long.
He turned abruptly and strode into the quiet corridor that connected with the command center. Han! Leia was rushing after him. Coolly, he stopped and turned to her.
Yes, Your Highness?
I thought you had decided to stay.
That bounty hunter we ran into on Ord Mantell changed my mind, Han said.
Does Luke know? The princess asked.
He'll know when he gets back, Han replied gruffly.
Princess Leia's eyes narrowed, her gaze judging him. For a moment, Han felt like one of the icicles on the surface of the planet.
"Don't give me that look," he said. "I'm going to pay off Jabba and get this price off my head while I still have a head."
"But we still need you,"
Leia said.
"We?
What about you?"
"Me?"
she said.
"I don't know what you mean."
Anger was growing in her voice again. Han smiled.
"You want me to stay because of the way you feel about me."
Again the princess mellowed.
"Well, yes, you've been a great help. To us. You're a natural leader."
Han cut her off. "No, your worship. That's not it." Suddenly, Leia started to laugh.
"You're imagining things."
"Am I? I think you were afraid I was going to leave you without even a..."
Han's eyes went to her lips.
"Kiss."
She began to laugh harder.
"I'd just as soon kiss a Wookiee."
"I can arrange that."
Han moved closer.
"Believe me, you could use a good kiss. You've been so busy giving orders, you've forgotten how to be a woman. If you'd let go for a moment, I could have helped you. But it's too late now, sweetheart. You're as cold as this planet."
"And you think you're the one to apply some heat?"
"Sure, if I were interested. But I don't think it'd be much fun."
Han stepped back and coolly appraised her.
"We'll meet again. Maybe by then you'll have warmed up a little."
Her look changed. Han had seen killers with kinder eyes.
"You have all the breeding of a bantha," she snarled, "but not as much class. Enjoy your trip, hotshot."
Princess Leia quickly turned away and hurried down the corridor. Luke's head was spinning, aching. With painstaking effort, he brought his vision into focus. He was in an icy gorge, and he was hanging upside down, arms dangling and fingertips some 30 centimeters from the snowy floor. His ankles were numb. He craned his neck and saw that his feet were frozen in ice, hanging from the ceiling, and that the ice was forming on his legs, like stalactites. Luke heard loud bestial moans and deafening roars resounding through the deep and narrow passageway of ice. With a determined effort, he pulled himself up and reached for the confining bonds. Too weak, Luke could not break the ice and fell back into his hanging position. Luke's eyes darted about the gorge, finally spotting the pile of gear he had brought with him on the mission, now lying in a useless crumpled heap, nearly a full, unattainable meter beyond his grasp. The device that held his attention was a stout hand grip unit with a pair of small switches and a surmounting metal disc. The object had once belonged to his father, a former Jedi Knight, who had been betrayed and murdered by the young Darth Vader. But now it was Luke's, given him by Ben Kenobi to be wielded with honor against Imperial tyranny. In desperation, Luke tried twisting his aching body just enough to reach the discarded lightsaber, but the freezing cold coursing through his body slowed him down and made him even weaker. Luke was beginning to resign himself to his fate as he heard the snarling ice creature approaching. His last feelings of hope were nearly gone when he sensed the presence. But it was not the presence of the white giant that dominated this gorge.
Rather, it was that soothing spiritual presence which occasionally visited Luke in moments of stress or danger. It was like a familiar voice, a whisper that spoke directly to Luke's mind. "Luke, think of the lightsaber in your hand."
The words made Luke's already aching head throb. Then he felt a sudden resurgence of strength, a feeling of confidence that urged him to continue fighting despite his apparently hopeless situation. His eyes fixed upon the lightsaber. His hand reached out painfully, his eyes squeezed shut in concentration. But the weapon was still beyond reach.
Gotta relax, Luke told himself. Relax. Let the force flow, Luke. The force.
Luke saw the inverted, gorilla-like image of the ice creature looming, its enormous arms ending in gleaming claws. And then the warrior forced the creature from his thoughts. He stopped struggling for his weapon. His body relaxed and went limp. He could feel coursing through him that energy field generated by all living beings that bound the very universe together. The Wampa ice creature spread its black hooked claws when suddenly the lightsaber, as if by magic, sprang to Luke's hand. Instantly, he depressed a colored button on the weapon, releasing a blade-like beam that quickly severed his icy bonds. As Luke, weapon in hand, dropped to the floor, the monstrous figure towering over him took a cautious step backward. Luke jumped to his feet and waved his lightsaber at the snow-white mass of muscle and hair, forcing it back a step, then another step. Bringing the weapon down, Luke cut through the monster's hide with a blade of light. The creature shrieked, turned, and hastily lumbered out of the gorge. Luke followed. The sky was noticeably darker, the winds even colder now. The force was with Luke, but even that power could not warm him. Every step he took as he stumbled out of the gorge was more difficult than the last. Finally, his vision dimming as rapidly as the daylight, Luke stumbled down an embankment of snow and was unconscious before he even reached the bottom. In the subsurface main hangar dock, Chewie was getting the Millennium Falcon ready for takeoff. He looked up to see a rather curious pair of figures appear from around a nearby corner. Neither was human, although one of them had a humanoid shape and gave the impression of a man in knightly armor. His movements were precise, almost too precise to be human, as he clanked stiffly through the corridor. His companion was rolling his shorter, barrel-like body along on miniature wheels, beeping and whistling excitedly.
"It is not my fault, you malfunctioning tin can," the tall droid countered with a gesture of its metallic hand. "Ah, here we are."
C-3PO paused to focus his optical sensors on the docked Millennium Falcon. The other robot, R2-D2, retracted his wheels and frontal leg and rested his stout metal body on the ground.
"Master Solo, sir,"
3PO called, the only one of the robotic twosome equipped with an imitation human voice.
"Mistress Leia has been trying to reach you on your communicator. It must be malfunctioning."
"I shut it off," Han said sharply and continued to work on his ship. "What does Her Royal Holiness want?"
3PO's auditory sensors identified the disdain in Han's voice, but did not understand it.
"She is looking for Master Luke, and assumed he would be here with you. No one seems to know..."
"Luke's not back yet?"
Han jumped off the Falcon's lift.
"Bolt it down, Chewie." "Officer of the deck," Han yelled, then brought his comlink to his mouth. "Security control. Has Commander Skywalker reported in yet?"
A negative reply brought a scowl to Han's face. The deck sergeant and his aide hurried up to Solo in response to his summons.
"Is Commander Skywalker back yet?" Han asked.
"I haven't seen him," the deck sergeant replied. "It's possible he came in through the south entrance."
"Check on it," Solo snapped. "It's urgent."
He turned and rushed into the main tunnel as the deck officer hurried toward him from the opposite direction.
"Sir,"
the man said frantically, "Commander Skywalker hasn't come through the south entrance."
"Are the speeders ready?" Han snapped.
"Not yet," the deck officer answered. "Adapting them to the cold is proving difficult. Maybe my morning..."
Han cut him off.
"We'll have to go out on Tauntauns. I'll take Sector 4.
The temperature is falling too rapidly."
"You bet it is," Han growled. "And Luke's out in it."
He pushed his way through rebel troops and took the reins of one of the trained Tauntauns, leaping onto the creature's back.
"The night storms will start before you can reach the first marker," the deck officer warned.
"Then I'll see you in hell," grunted Han,
tugging the reins of the mount and maneuvering the animal out of the cave. Snow was falling heavily as Han raced his tauntaun through the wilderness. Night was near, and the winds were howling fiercely. Han drove his mount harder, forcing it on across the icy plains. It was not long before the tauntaun was moaning pitifully, its legs becoming more and more unsteady. Somehow, Luke was still alive, though barely, and struggling to stay that way, even with the night storms violently assaulting him. He painfully pulled himself upright from the snow, only to be blasted back down by the freezing gale. It took all of his remaining strength to drag himself a half meter before finally collapsing, sinking into the ever-deepening drifts. I can't, he said, though no one could hear his words. But someone, though still unseen, had heard. You must. The words vibrated in Luke's mind. Luke, look at me. With a great effort, Luke lifted his head. In front of him, unaffected by the cold and still clad in his shabby robes, stood Ben Kenobi. You must survive, Luke, the apparition said with gentle authority. The young commander found the strength to move his lips. I'm cold, so cold. You must go to the Dagobah system, the spectral figure instructed. You will learn from Yoda, the Jedi Master, the one who taught me. Luke reached to touch the ghostly figure. Ben! Ben! Luke, you are our only hope. Before Luke could gather the strength to ask for an explanation, the figure began to fade, and when every trace of the apparition had passed from sight, Luke thought he saw the approach of a tauntaun with a human rider on its back. Ben? The young rebel commander called out, and then lost consciousness. The snow lizard was barely able to stand on its saurian hind legs when Han dismounted. He looked with horror at the snow-covered, almost frozen form lying at his feet. Come on, buddy, he appealed. You aren't dead yet. Han could detect no sign of life and noticed that Luke's face was savagely torn. He rubbed at the youth's face, careful not to touch the drying wounds. Don't do this, Luke. It's not your time. Give me a signal here. Finally, a low moan, barely audible over the winds. Han grinned with relief. Oh, we've got to get you out of here. He picked Luke up and carried him toward the tauntaun. But before he could drape the unconscious form over the animal's back, the snow lizard gave an agonized roar and collapsed into a shaggy heap. Laying his companion down, Han rushed to the side of the fallen creature. It was dead. Han went to work quickly. He knew he hadn't much time. Grabbing Luke's lightsaber, he began to cut through the thick skin of the tauntaun. A foul odor rose from the steaming incision, and Han winced. There were few things he could remember that stank like a snow lizard's innards. He tossed the slippery entrails onto the snow. When the animal's corpse had been entirely eviscerated, Han shoved his friend inside the warm, hair-covered skin. I know this doesn't smell so good, but it'll keep you from freezing. Han's freezing hands went to the supply pack strapped to the tauntaun's back and found the shelter container. He fought to open it and stiffly began to construct the one piece of rebel equipment that might protect them both, if only for a short while longer. If I don't get this up fast, he grumbled to himself, Jabba won't need those bounty hunters.
Hoth's sky was black with night. Princess Leia Organa stood inside the rebel base entrance, maintaining a worried vigil. Chewbacca sat nearby, his maned head lifting quickly from his hairy hands as 3PO and R2 re-entered the hangar.
R2 has not been able to pick up any signals, 3PO reported, humanly distraught.
Nearby, Major Derlin looked at Princess Leia.
Your Highness, he said, his voice heavy with regret, the temperature is dropping fast. The shield doors must be closed. I'm sorry. The speeders should be ready in the morning. They'll make the search easier.
Is there any chance of their surviving the night? Leia asked.
Slim, Major Derlin answered with grim honesty.
Around them, the only sound was the echoing clang of metal slamming against metal. The huge doors of the rebel base were closing for the night. Chewbacca let out a mournful Wookiee howl of grief.
Something had invaded the morning air of the ice world. A relatively small, snub-nosed craft, with dark cockpit windows and laser guns mounted on each side. The rebel snowspeeder was heavily armored and designed for warfare near the planet's surface. But this morning, the small craft was on a reconnaissance mission. Zev, the ship's only occupant, scanned the desolate stretches below, praying he would find the objects of his search before he went snowblind. Presently, he heard a low, beeping signal.
Echo Base! He shouted jubilantly into his cockpit comlink. I've got something. Not much, but I'm closing in.
Zev reduced his speed and banked. As the white infinity of Hoth's terrain streaked under him, he switched to a new frequency.
Echo 3, this is Rogue 2. Do you copy? Commander Skywalker, this is Rogue 2.
At first, all he heard was static. But then he heard a voice, very distant-sounding, yet edged with cynicism, fighting its way through the crackling noise.
Nice of you guys to drop in. Hope we didn't get you up too early.
A thick glass window separated the battered, near-frozen body of Luke Skywalker from his four watching friends. Han Solo stood beside Leia, his Wookiee co-pilot, R2-D2, and 3PO. Han felt only relief, knowing the young commander was finally out of danger and in the best mechanical hands. Clad only in white shorts, Luke hung inside a transparent cylinder, a combination breath mask and microphone covering his nose and mouth. The surgeon droid, 2-1B, was attending to the youth with the skill of the finest humanoid doctors. He worked a switch, and a gelatinous red fluid began pouring down over his human patient. Bacta, Han thought. It can work miracles. As the bubbling slime encapsulated his body, Luke began to thrash about.
Watch out! He raved. Snow creatures. Dangerous. Yoda. Go to Yoda. Only hope.
Han had no idea what his friend was raving about. Leia looked at the grim-faced Solo.
Han, she began tentatively, I don't know how...
Forget it, he said brusquely.
Right now he was concerned only with his friend and the red fluid. For a while, it appeared as if Luke were trying to resist the curative flow of the translucent muck. Then, at last, he gave up his mumbling and relaxed. 2-1B turned to gaze at Han and the others through the window.
Commander Skywalker is now out of danger, the robot announced.
Luke sat up on his bed in the Rebel Medical Center as a medical droid removed the protective pad from his healing face. His eyes were uncovered, and he began to perceive the face of someone standing by his bed. The smiling image of Princess Leia came into focus. She moved toward him, gently brushed his hair out of his eyes, and looked at his healing wounds. Does it still hurt? Across the room, the door banged open. R2 beeped a cheerful greeting as he rolled toward Luke, and 3PO clanked noisily toward Luke's bed.
Master Luke, it's good to see you functional again.
Before Luke could reply, Han Solo and Chewbacca burst in,
Hi, kid, Han greeted him boisterously. That's two you owe me. He gave the princess a wide, devilish grin. Well, your worship, it looks like you arranged to keep me close by for a while longer.
I had nothing to do with it, Leia said hotly. General Rican thinks it's dangerous for any ships to leave the system until the generators are operational.
I think you just can't bear to let me out of your sight.
I don't know where you get your delusions, laser brains, she retorted. Chewbacca let out a roaring Wookiee laugh.
Laugh it up, fuzzball, Han said.
In the distance, a warning alarm blared through the subterranean corridors. Han Solo and Chewbacca burst into the Rebel Command Center and found General Rican conferring with his head controller, Princess Leia and 3PO listening.
I think we have a visitor, General Rican said.
Whatever it is, it's metal, the sensor controller said.
Just then, the voice of a Rebel trooper cut in through the console's comlink speaker.
This is Echo Station 3-8. Unidentified object is in our scope. We should have visual contact in about...
Fear suddenly filled the voice.
What the... Oh, no!
There was a burst of static, and then nothing. Han frowned.
Whatever it isn't friendly. Let's have a look, Chewie.
Even before Han and Chewbacca were out of the chamber, General Rican had dispatched Rogues 10 and 11 to Station 3-8. The mammoth Imperial Star Destroyer occupied a position of deadly prominence in the Emperor's fleet. The sleekly elongated ship was larger and even more ominous than the five other wedge-shaped Imperial Star Destroyers guarding it. Flanking the Star Destroyers were a number of smaller fighter ships, and darting about this great space armada were the infamous TIE fighters. Supreme confidence reigned in the heart of every crew member in this Imperial Death Squadron, especially among the personnel on the monstrous Central Star Destroyer. But something else also blazed within their souls. Fear. Fear of merely the sound of the familiar, heavy footsteps of their much-feared but much-respected leader as they echoed through the enormous ship. Towering above them in his black cloak and concealing black headgear, Darth Vader, Dark Lord of the Sith, entered the main control deck. The men around him fell silent. For a moment, the only sounds came from the ship's control boards and the loud wheezes coming from the ebony figure's metal breath screen. As Darth Vader watched the endless array of stars, Captain Piet rushed across the wide bridge of the ship, carrying a message for the squat, evil-looking Admiral Ozzel.
I think we've found something, Admiral, he announced nervously.
Yes, Captain.
The Admiral was a supremely confident man, relaxed even in the presence of his cloaked superior.
The report we have is only a fragment from a probe droid in the Hoth system, but it's the only lead we've had in...
I want proof, Ozzel broke in angrily. Not leads. With thousands of probe droids searching the galaxy, I have no intention of chasing around from one side of...
You found something?
The figure in black interrupted and approached the two.
Yes, sir, Captain Piet said, choosing his words with caution. We have visuals. The system is supposed to be devoid of human forms.
Vader was no longer listening. His masked face turned toward an image beamed on one of the view screens, an image of a small squadron of rebel snowspeeders streaking above the white fields.
That's it, Darth Vader boomed.
My lord, Admiral Ozzel protested, it could be smugglers.
That is the one,
the former Jedi Knight insisted, clenching his black-gloved fist.
And Skywalker is with them. Admiral, set your course for the Hoth system.
The Imperial probe droid raised a large antenna and sent out a piercing high-frequency signal. The robot scanners had reacted to a life form, noting the appearance of a brown Wookiee head. The probe's blasters took aim when a red beam exploded suddenly from behind, nicking its darkly finished hull. Han Solo ducked behind a snow dune and watched the robot spin around in midair to face him. Good. Now he was the target. The floating machine fired, and Han fired his hand blaster again, hitting it square on. A high-pitched whine came from the deadly machine, and in an instant, the Imperial probe droid burst into a billion or more flaming pieces.
I'm afraid there's not much left, Han said over the comlink to the underground base. It must have had a self-destruct.
Princess Leia and General Rekin were at the console.
What is it? She asked.
Droid of some kind, Han answered.
Leia paused.
An Imperial droid.
If it was, Han warned, the Empire knows we're here.
General Rekin shook his head. We'd better start to evacuate the planet. 6 ominous shapes appeared in the black space of the Hoth system, looming like vast demons of destruction. Inside the largest of the 6 Imperial space destroyers, Darth Vader received General Veers in a small spherical room.
What is it?
My lord, the general replied, choosing each word with care, the fleet has moved out of light speed. ComScan has detected an energy field protecting an area of the 6th planet in the Hoth system. The field is strong enough to deflect any bombardment. Vader rose to his full 2-meter height.
So, the rebel scum are alerted to our presence.
Furious, he clenched his black-gloved hands.
Admiral Ozzel came out of light speed too close to the system. He is as clumsy as he is stupid. Prepare your troops for a surface attack.
General Veers turned and marched out. Alone in the chamber, Darth Vader activated a large view screen that showed his Star Destroyer's vast bridge. Admiral Ozzel stepped forward with a look of trepidation, but Vader ignored him.
Captain Piet.
Captain Piet stepped forward as the Admiral staggered back a step, his hand automatically reaching for his throat.
Yes, my lord, Piet answered.
Ozzel began to gag as his throat, as if in the grip of invisible talons, began to constrict.
Make ready to land assault troops beyond the energy field, Vader ordered. Then deploy the fleet so that nothing can get off that planet. You're in command now, Admiral Piet.
Beyond Piet, Ozzel's face contorted hideously as he fought for one final breath of air. Then he dropped into a dead heap on the floor. The Empire had entered the system of Hoth. Rebel troops rushed to their alert stations as the warning alarms wailed through the ice tunnels. In the hangar, Princess Leia addressed a small band of rebel fighter pilots. The large transport ships will leave as soon as they're loaded. Only 2 fighter escorts per ship. The energy shield can only be opened for a split second, so you'll have to stay very close to the transports. The ion cannon will fire several blasts, which should destroy any ships in your path. When you clear the energy shield, you will proceed to the rendezvous point. Good luck.
First transport approaching shield,
one of the rebel controllers said, tracking a bright image that could only be an Imperial Star Destroyer.
Prepare to open shield, a radar man ordered. Stand by iron control, another controller said.
A giant metal globe on Hoth's icy surface rotated into position and angled its great turret gun upward.
Fire! Came the order from General Rekin.
Suddenly, two red beams of destructive energy were released into the cold skies. The beams almost immediately overtook the first of the racing rebel transport craft. The twin red bolts struck the enormous star destroyer and blasted its conning tower. Explosions set off by the blast began to rock the great flying fortress, spinning it out of control and plunging it into deep space. Luke pulled on his heavy weather gear and watched the pilots, gunners, and R2 units hurrying to complete their tasks. On the way to the row of snowspeeders, he paused at the tail section of the Millennium Falcon, where Han Solo and Chewbacca were working frantically to re-weld the ship's right lifter. "Chewie," Luke called, "take care of yourself, and watch over this guy, will you?" The Wookiee barked a farewell, gave Luke a big hug, then turned back to resume work. Luke and Han looked at each other, perhaps for the last time. "I hope you make your peace with Jabba," Luke said at last.
"Give him hell, kid," the Corellian responded lightly. The public address system broke in on their unspoken thoughts. "First transport is clear."
A cheer burst from those gathered in the hangar. Luke turned and hurried over to his snowspeeder. He threw one last look back over his shoulder. Han was still staring after him. Dak, Luke's fresh-faced young gunner, was standing outside the ship waiting for him. "How are you feeling, sir?" he asked.
"Like new, Dak."
C-3PO and R2 stood amid the rapidly moving personnel as the pilots readied for departure.
"Why is it," 3PO asked, "when things seem to get settled, everything falls apart?"
Leaning forward, he gently patted the other droid's hull.
"Take good care of Master Luke, and take good care of yourself."
R2 whistled and tooted a goodbye, then turned to roll down the ice corridor.
This program is continued on the other side of this cassette.